We decided several months ago that it was important for us to, as a board, to go through the various elements which may be found in our effluent as we decide what beneficial uses we can put that to, and this is one in that series. Obviously, it's a subject matter that is of concern to a lot of us as well as you, and that's why you're here. And so I'm glad you're in attendance. There will be some time for public comments, but recognize that this is a study session. The primary purpose, therefore, is for us to become, at the board level, more informed about some of the issues with pharmaceuticals and the waste stream. And if we have some time in our agenda, I will allow people to speak briefly as well if you have comments or questions. There are blue cards. There should be a backup at the top, or if you raise your hand, we'll get one to you so that I can control how many speakers, and then I can determine how much time will be available for public comment. So sit back and relax. We have a wonderful panel of experts here with us, and I'm sure we're all going to know a little bit more about this in about an hour and 15 minutes. And with that, Dr. Smith.
Indeed, it is a pleasure to be here today, to be accompanied by experts, each of which are so highly accomplished in their respective fields. I want to start out by acknowledging the time commitment that they've made to be here today. Dr. Snyder from Southern Nevada Water Authority, we owe him a debt of gratitude for the changes he made in his schedule to be here and the priority that his agency was willing to give this event. Dr. Derazinski from the, Stanford University likewise took time out of an extremely busy schedule, and I will describe some aspects of his schedule and commitments in a few minutes when I introduce him more formally later. And I also want to recognize the firm of Kennedy Jenks. They made a substantial contribution to this effort as well, and I want to thank particularly Craig Lichty for his efforts in making this event today happen. As the director mentioned in his introductory remarks, this is an issue, the personal care pharmaceutical product issue has been a growing one over a number of years. In recent years, there's been a great deal of additional research, considerable research since the last time we had a study session on this topic about 2 years ago. And so the purpose today is to bring you up to speed from that study session where we covered these issues a couple of years ago, because this year you will be facing some decisions about how to allocate your recycled water, and this is an important piece of information for you to have as you recognize when you requested an update on this topic. But I want to also point out that it is not new to this board. Even before 2005, as early as 1996, this board requested information about personal care and pharmaceutical products in their recycled water. It was an element of the information. The current state of science was an element of the information in the EIR that was prepared in 1996 that was the basis for your selection of the Geysers Recharge Project. And again, we updated that in 2004 with a current state of information in the incremental program EIR. And we will do so again when the discharge project EIR is available for public comment later this summer. So this is a complementary effort today to those documents that have been prepared and continue to be available to the public and continue to be updated. What I'll be doing today is, usually you have the misfortune of listening to me speak, thankfully, you would say I'll minimize that today and defer to the experts, and I will be introducing them each as in their turn and providing a little bit of background on them, and I'll start with Dr. Jean DeBrew. He's going to be discussing the occurrence and fate of these PPCPs, sort of an introduction to the topic, primer on it before we get into some more details, and then he will get into some details on his own. Dr. DeBrew, besides having a doctorate in engineering chemistry, did his postdoctoral work on this very topic at Stanford University on the fate and transport of these compounds in the environment. He has taught a course on this subject at Stanford, although I'm sure the course at Berkeley would be superior to that course that he taught at Stanford. He is an active member of the Water Reuse Foundation, and his role there is to identify important research topics to foster reuse and to allocate millions of dollars to research. And this is one of the topics that he has and his colleagues on that committee have identified as a high priority topic. He's a consultant also with the firm of Kennedy Jenks, and he's been involved in projects where personal care and pharmaceutical products are an important issue, including the desalination project in Marin County and advanced recycled water treatment project in Santa Clara County. He's been invited to speak on this topic around the United States and around the world, and we consider ourselves fortunate to have him on the team of consultants advising you on an ongoing basis, as well as being able to present to you here today. So, Dr. DeBrew.
Thank you, Dave. And I'd like to thank the chairman and the board for having me back. I was, I gave that a part of the presentation in 2005, and hopefully I'll be repeating some of the information then, because there is a little bit of background that's needed to get us to this point of this topic, because it is somewhat unique in the water quality game. But I also have updates, and hopefully that is educational for the board and the general public. Just a general background. Typical discharge requirements for Northern California is plant performance of the effluent quality, BOD, settleable solids, turbidity, beneficial use protection, pathogens, priority pollutants, nutrients, pH ammonia, amongst others. And then there's receiving water regulations also, assuring the habitat is appropriate for the use of that water, oxygen, temperature, turbidities, others. And currently, these pharmaceuticals and personal care products, for lack of a better term, and I'll get to that next, are not regulated. So let's talk a little, let's talk a little bit about nomenclature here. When I talk about pharmaceuticals and personal care products, that's probably the most inclusive term that we have for these non-regulated, primarily organic compounds found in waters. There's a lot of use of the word endocrine-disrupting compounds, and it's important, but endocrine-disrupting compounds, it's a different use because it's an endpoint. So there's endocrine disruption associated with these compounds. But there's also industrial chemicals and non-regulated disinfection byproducts. But basically, waters in general, whether they're recycled waters or lesser-treated wastewaters or drinking waters, have numerous organic compounds in them. Okay, sources of non-regulated compounds. Currently in the United States, 60,000 to 80,000 chemicals are currently in use. A fraction of those can be present in recycled waters. And the introduction into waters include several different, but what we're really kind of focusing in on here is a domestic industrial discharge not completely removed during municipal wastewater treatment. So what compounds are not completely treated? It's, again, a fraction of that 60 to 80,000 that make it into the waste stream and to our treatment plant. So basically, the water has to be soluble. The compound has to be soluble enough in water to make it through the treatment plant. If it's insoluble, it's going to be associated with the solids of a treatment plant. It can't be very volatile, or it'll escape to the air. And it has to be not easily biodegradable because wastewater treatment is the major component of it is a biological treatment, and compounds can be biodegraded. So it's a fraction of those that fall into kind of those categories. Which compounds can possibly pose risk? Again, we're talking about organic compounds here, and they have to be significantly used by society. So of those 60 to 80,000, which ones that get into the waste stream? And then all things equal, and this is a generality, the smaller compounds with a molecular weight of 500 Daltons or less have a greater possibility of posing a risk because they can pass through cell walls easier. This is a generality, but I just want to kind of lay those out. Now, what are we talking about here compared to water quality constituents and current federal and state regulations? All right, here we are looking at a scale of concentrations that are used for water. And when we're up around this end, parts per thousand, that's what we're talking about, salinity. Okay, so when we're talking about an ocean water, we have 35 parts per thousand, or 35 grams per liter. And if we go down three orders of magnitude, or 1,000 times less, we have parts per million. And that's where we find our regulated constituents, between parts per million and parts per billion. We're talking about dissolved organic carbon, inorganic ions. When we get down to the lower ones, parts per billion, we're talking about pesticide residues or disinfection byproducts. And then when we get lower than that, down to nanograms, parts per trillion, or picograms per liter even, parts per quadrillion, this is the range that we're talking about for these non-regulated pharmaceuticals and personal care products. And there is the reason there is a concern about that is some of these compounds, the endocrine disrupting compounds, are active within organisms down at these very low concentrations. Okay, what is a part per million, part per billion, part per trillion? If you expand that scale up, if you were to say 1 liter was an Olympic-sized swimming pool, a part per million is a quart of milk or a quart of water in that Olympic-sized swimming pool. A part per billion is a sugar cube in an Olympic-sized swimming pool. And a part per trillion is a couple grains of sand in an Olympic-sized swimming pool, just to give you an idea of the concentrations that we're looking at here. Okay. Potential human health risks associated with these, and we'll hear quite a bit more from this from the other speakers, but I just want to introduce this. Endocrine disruption seems to be the primary concern because of the concentrations and the doses are so low compared to medicinal doses for pharmaceuticals. It's believed that there's negligible medicinal effects, but there's worries about synergistic effects and currently unknown effects with low concentrations. But one important point to make for endocrine disrupting compounds, there's a range of activity levels for these compounds. So the hormone that's in your body that is acting to turn things on and off, other things can disrupt that activity, other chemicals in society. But they don't do so as efficiently as that particular hormone. Or they can if they're designed for that, but most endocrine disruptors do a much worse job at it, and up to 10,000 times worse job at that. So there's a range of activities, about five orders of magnitude, that should be taken to or is taken to an, into account when you're looking at the a potential impact by these compounds. Okay, environmental risks. There have been effects observed in wildlife. In 95, there was a paper of a study done in the Thames River in England where feminization of male fish in effluent-dominated river was seen. So there's a natural occurrence of hermaphroditic nature of fish, so basically possessing both male and female sexual organ characteristics of 10% and downstream of wastewater discharge that was seen to be 50%. That really, although a lot of information was known before this point, that's really rung the alarm regarding, is there an impact to wildlife and what is causing that and why? And since then, there's been cases reported in other places in Europe and within the United States. And the first real widespread reported case is from the Las Vegas Wash. And our speaker, Shane Snyder, coming up, will talk at length about that situation and what they've done there to try to find out information about this issue. Okay. Since I was here last time, we've had a continued and focused interest on the fish feminization and found that it's a very complex issue. And there's quite a bit of references on this slide and the next couple slides. And I did this for being able to access information about this topic later. And what we found is in the field studies that are observed with fish feminization, they really fall into two categories. Either the treatment level is low, either a primary or secondary wastewater treatment, or the percent of the wastewater in that surface water is very high. So it's an effluent dominated stream or with a highly treated, or an effluent dominated stream with a lower treated wastewater. And there's also field studies that have been conducted in Alabama and Michigan that show no observed fish feminization downstream of a wastewater treatment plant. So there's a little bit of contradiction there. And then there's lab studies where they remove the water and they do this work in the lab, which takes away the other possible impacts of things going on in the field. And there's been impacts seen at high concentrations of wastewater. I want to present two studies that have relevance to the sub-regional plan in the city of Santa Rosa. There's an EPA study that was recently published where the sub-regional plant participated by giving effluent samples, and fish feminization was determined by a vitellogenin level response. Vitellogenin level is a protein produced by female fish for egg production. And when a male fish is exposed to an estrogen, they produce this vitellogenin. That's used as an indicator for fish feminization. 46 effluents were evaluated. 10 effluents showed an elevated vitellogenin level in males, 2 effluents showed reduced vitellogenin levels in females, and the subregional plant effluent did not show an effect. Another study where the fact sheet just came out a couple days ago, but the report came out last year, was a swamp study where 113 surface waters were sampled, and quite a few samples were taken within the Santa Rosa Plain. And vitellogenin again was used as an indicator of fish feminization. And 6 samples of the 113 taken in Northern California and the Central Valley, 6 samples induced marginal yet statistically significant increases in vitellogenin. And the locations downstream of the subregional plant showed no effect. So that's what we have for the local studies going on right now. Okay, now I wanted to kind of walk you through the occurrence. We have, this may be a little bit difficult to see, but there are 4 wastewater treatment plants here with influent and effluent concentrations of these different compounds of pharmaceuticals and personal care products. And because this is such because this is a topic with a very, very large potential implications, What is grabbed oftentimes by the media is that these compounds escape treatment, and that these compounds, although treatment is not designed to remove these compounds, treatment does a pretty good job in removing them. Does that mean it removes them all? Conventional treatment does not. So you have an influx into a treatment plant, and then you have a lower concentration coming out of the, or in the wastewater treatment plant effluent. Moving on, when you come out of a wastewater treatment plant, we've seen the occurrence studies. The USGS study is probably the most publicized, and although there have been numerous others, I just continue to use this example. 139 highly impacted streams across the country were surveyed for 95 different non-regulated compounds, and 80% of the streams sampled contained one or more of the compounds. And numerous streams contained many of these compounds. And since then, with the other occurrence studies, occurrence is consistent nationwide and internationally where PPCPs are available. So they're getting into our waste streams to a certain level getting into the effluents from the treatment plants and into surface waters. Okay, here I have natural attenuation seen in surface waters and the subsurface in the next two plants. This is an example from Southern California in Orange County, the Santa Ana River. As it moves down, this is an effluent-dominated river, especially in the summertime when they get very, very little rain. And there are wastewater treatment plant discharges to this river. The data shown here shows these, due to those inputs, wastewater treatment plant inputs, you get concentrations of these compounds in the river water. And over time, through travel down the river, there is a decrease in those compounds. So there are mechanisms in the natural environment that cause these compounds to be reduced. Photodegradation, adsorption onto the sediments, and biodegradation are the primary ones. And then there's also attenuation in the subsurface. I've normalized the concentrations of several families of non-regulated compounds here to be one it at the starting point, and as they travel through the subsurface with retention times of days to hundreds of days to thousands of days, those concentrations decrease. Now, there are compounds that have been seen that persist in groundwater for years at a time, but it's a small fraction of the total total organic matter that's put into the ground. Now, I just wanted to add a slide here that has a couple of stories about these compounds. The analytics are getting very, very good, and we'll hear a little more about this with another speaker, but we're able to measure things much lower than we have been before. And from the work that I'm doing with the different project that I'm in, I'm finding that these compounds are pretty much everywhere at very, very low concentrations, but there's quite a bit of the flame retardants used, for example, in the carpet here in a public space, because the risk of this place catching on fire versus those concentrations is greater or perceived to be greater. So there's a lab in British Columbia that measures flame retardants at very, very low concentrations, and they have a hard time keeping these things out of their lab blanks. They don't wear typical lab coats. They don't have any foam in their laboratory, and they don't use they don't have computers in the laboratory because all of those can contaminate their samples for flame retardants, and they still see flame retardants in their lab blanks. So we're getting to the point where we can measure things at such low concentrations that we're seeing the environmental levels of these. Also, we find that with measuring phthalates. Phthalates are really hard to measure without blank contamination. And there is one client that we routinely do sampling for, and if we use a bottled water instead of an ultra-pure water from the laboratory, we see phthalates much higher than the concentrations that we're trying to measure for. So with that, I'm going to leave it and pass it on to the next speaker.
The next speaker, Brenda Edelman, represents the Russian River Watershed Protection Committee. Brenda is not, as this board knows, a technical person, but Brenda has been invited to address you today because she represents a concerned citizen perspective. And Brenda has been following this issue for many, many years. She identified it early as an important issue and has been concerned about it for a long time, and we felt for that reason it was appropriate that she have the opportunity to describe to you her concerns about these compounds in the environment and in recycled water. So, Ms. Edelman.
Well, you know, about a month ago you asked me to take part in this, and I'm very honored, and I'm also, I want to honor the city for having this. I think it shows a lot of foresight on your part. In 1995, we put on our group put on a major conference with Theo Colburn, Luke Gillette, and several others who are well known in the field, in this field. And basically, we've been following it ever since. So when I was asked to speak on it, I went into immediate panic mode because I thought, well, I have, what, 10, 12 minutes, and how do I cover this subject in such an enormous enormous subject in such a short amount of time? So basically, there's a few things I want to do. I handed out a packet to you. It has a picture of the Russian River on it. I just want to tell you that's an award-winning photograph from 1992 from a land trust competition, and it's a picture of the bridge at Hacienda, which is where you measure to determine how much wastewater you're going to discharge. There's a USGS site right at that spot. So I thought it was an appropriate picture to put on the cover. The book contains about 200 pages. I went through hundreds and hundreds of articles to pick out the articles that are intelligent and appropriate and also understandable. I need to tell everyone here, I am not a scientist. I struggle with a lot of this information. It gets really complicated if you get into any of the studies, and it's a whole different language, and it's like, you know, Greek or Italian or Spanish or whatever. If you only know English, you can really get lost. So basically, I included just many of some of the most important documents, and there's also in some cases the first page of studies, so there's hundreds of references in there. So if you, in your leisure time, have, instead of watching TV some night, want to look through that, you can just really learn a lot about this whole subject from reading these articles. Basically, I also want to allude in the packet also are a few other documents and also a lengthy article. I wrote a six-page. I started to write out my comments for today. I never got it together to do a PowerPoint. And I ended up writing six pages of comments and thinking, well, I can't stand up here and read these comments to you. So if I seem a little bit disjointed, I have a number of things I want to cover, and I have different pieces of paper here, and so I hope I can do it in an order that makes sense. I want to comment on one thing, a few things Dr. DeBruce said. He said that, I believe he said something about hits of estrogen or more compounds in areas where the wastewater percentage is very high. And in the letter he responded to me that came to me, I had sent some articles to the city council, and Mayor Blanchard sent a letter in response that repeated some comments or quoted some comments for Dr. DeBruce, and which It was stated that, well, Santa Rosa measures their discharge at Hacienda and they only discharge 5%. But what was neglected to say was that that the discharge is in the Laguna 12 to 14 miles away, and the intensity of the discharge, the amount of effluent in the wastewater there, is very, very high. And so we don't really know. One of the things I want to say clearly is that there is a lot of information, that this is a brand new science in a lot of ways, and there's so much we don't know. And so we have to be very careful with the information we do have and not drawing conclusions that are inappropriate, because I find with science, you know, every day there's a new discovery, and it's something that, you know, we have to be aware over time that what we believe is truth today is not going to be truth tomorrow or the next day. So anyway, there's a few points in the letter that I want to mention, highlight. Endocrine disruptors and also all of the other chemicals we put in the waterways are unregulated chemicals. I think it's important to say that they're not regulated, and therefore we really don't know that much about them. There's been more and more discoveries about impacts on fish and wildlife and concerns about human health that people believe are a result of all the chemistry we're exposed to. And some of the chemistry, there's particular concern because there's been discovery of problems with fish downstream of wastewater discharges. And it certainly makes a lot of sense because we all know that all of us contribute to the problem. It's part of our society. It's the way we live. We all have cleaning products and pharmaceuticals in our cabinets, and on and on and on. And so we need to discover what are the bad actors, what are the things we need to find substitutes for and get rid of. And one example in terms of pharmaceuticals is the big message starting to go out now is do not flush old medicines down the toilet. And it's best, people are starting to talk about collection programs at pharmacies and whatnot, drugstores. So all these are signs, all the problems we're seeing are signs, and somewhere I have a list here of all the problems. It's sort of out of order, but anyway, I'll get back to that. But at any rate, these are the tip of the iceberg. One interesting thing was stated at the Laguna conference a few weeks ago is I believe that it was in reference to Santa Rosa Creek, where the plant life and the vegetation above the creek were in fine condition, but at the bottom of the creek was a dead zone and there was virtually no aquatic life. So we don't really have a good idea of what all these chemicals are doing to the aquatic life. Another thing, concern, is that we don't know what kind of secondary impacts these chemicals and pharmaceuticals are having. In other words, and just as an example, well, I don't know if that's a good example, but sometimes what happens is that wildlife and probably humans too are exposed to chemicals. And they don't kill us or cause immediate disease, but they affect our well-being and our, they just lower our resistance so that if any other kind of infection comes along or any other problem happens, then we are in a situation where the original exposure didn't kill us, but the second problem did. And in fact, some people think that maybe in situations with cancer that our immune systems get impaired somehow, and exposures to environmental toxins put us in a situation where we're more vulnerable. So at any rate, one of the things I wanted to address were those studies that were mentioned. There was mention of a study where they collected Santa Rosa's waste. They collected wastewater from, I don't know, 45 or 50 treatment plants across the country, the EPA, and they did studies on the whether there was any estrogen or I think it was vitellogenin responses. And Santa Rosa did get a clear, you know, there was no problem in Santa Rosa's wastewater. But I want to emphasize that that was just one sample. And you can't draw conclusions. I'm real concerned that these studies, because Santa Rosa came out pretty good in these studies, I'm really concerned that this may be seen as a signal that everything's A-OK when we don't really know that. And in looking at those studies, so that was one of the studies. The other study was the swamp study. And I had several concerns about that. Basically, there was only one place, I think it was at Willowside in Santa Rosa Creek again, where there was any hit at all, and it was a small amount of estrogen that was found. And so it didn't really show up, but there was something interesting with this test, and that is that they did 13 different phases with it, and our area and the Sacramento area were tested. And only the first four samples they did for only a day. They studied it for only a day to see if anything, and they didn't really find much. And then they switched it to EPA. They switched labs, and EPA did about eight more phases where they kept the samples for 8 days. And one of the things that I was told was that the longer you do this, the more of a response you would get. So it's possible if they had to go for 16 or 20 days, there may have been more that showed up. So one of the questions I had about that study was an 8-day exposure enough? Santa Rosa was involved, Santa Rosa's wastewater, or I'm sorry, this didn't really look at wastewater. This just looked at the streams, the ambient waters of the local streams. And so here I have a list of what was found. Okay, there were only four samples taken in the discharge season. And none of those were in the Laguna. So we really didn't get a test of the water when there was wastewater in it. And there were 8 samples taken in the Russian River altogether during non-discharge season. There were 4 samples taken in the Russian River during discharge season. And the study didn't really tell you precisely where. There was a list of monitoring points, but it didn't really tell you where each of the specific samples were taken. So all I'm trying to say is it was very limited data, and I'm just concerned that the city not feel that that everything, it went far enough, and we really need to continue looking at these issues. And we really don't know what impacts the chemicals are having, and we see in our own waterway, there's just not been that much study of the aquatic life in the waterway that I'm aware of, but we do know that there's 3 endangered salmonid species. And that's a real indicator that a lot of other things could be wrong, too. One of the things that came out of our conference and is spoken about a lot, and I wish I could go into it in more detail, but it's basically it's referred to as the precautionary principle, and I'd just like to read one sentence to you, and it says, "When an activity raises threats of harm to human health or the environment, Precautionary measures should be taken even if some cause and effect relationships are not fully established scientifically. And this refers to, over time, we have required that there be risk assessments for, and before we have regulations on various different chemicals. And it becomes a problem because if you take, like, for example, cigarette smoking, and the fact that I don't know if you can even prove in any individual case, I know that they've tried, I don't know if they did it definitively, precisely at what point, what particular toxin caused someone to get lung cancer, assuming they're a smoker. At what point and what caused the cancer? And for years, the cigarette companies would say, well, you know, you haven't proved that there's a problem from our product. And what the precautionary principle states basically is that when you're not sure and when the potential harm is so great, you should err on the side of being careful as opposed to using it as an excuse to move forward and take action to build projects, for instance, without considering the potential problems. One of the things I want to mention is that very small doses that they're discovering now, and this is in the book I gave you, that they're discovering that at times in some circumstances very small doses are even more impactful than larger doses are. And this is particularly true with atrazine and the impact on frogs. And there's a scientist, Tyrone Hayes, who's done a lot of work on this. And there's a whole article in here on his work, and also there's some other articles on this fact. So that when you say, well, Santa Rosa just had a very small amount of estrogen, for example, that small amount could have major impacts. And so it's really important that just saying something is a small amount doesn't get you off the hook, because it can have a big impact. For instance, infant and juvenile fish, as well as juveniles of any species, are particularly vulnerable. We don't know what the impact is on young males if the mother has been exposed when the child was an infant or in the womb. There are certain phases of development that are more vulnerable than others. A lot of times the time of the exposure in the either a human being or a fish or a wildlife creature, the actual time of exposure, the point at which the exposure occurs, can be very significant. And the life stage could be, what stage of life is that being at when the exposure occurs? The duration and the level of exposure, for instance, there are all these chemicals. We don't know how they act in combination. And when the fish are swimming around these chemicals, not for a day or 8 days, they're potentially exposed to it for long periods of time. So there's a lot of concern about that the fish and wildlife are exposed for extended periods to a mixture of chemicals whose effects we don't even know what they do. Well, the number of samples and duration of the exposure was so limited in that test that it'd be hard to extrapolate from it a sense of security about the potential problem. And the study just looked at estrogen, and it didn't look at intergenerational or other effects. And just finally, I'll just say, when you eat fish, you are eating what they ate. And do these studies make you any more secure than your food source is perfectly safe? And I wonder why it might be a good idea to study the fish living in the waters that are supposedly free of estrogen. I wish there were more studies in our local area. And maybe there's some I don't know about. I don't know. At any rate, I feel like I hope I've lent some addition to this in terms of hitting on some of the concerns. I feel that there's a lot of people in this room who could probably greatly enlarge on what I've said. I hope this book is of help to you in exploring these issues even further, and I look forward to hearing the rest of the speakers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Edelman, for your comments and participating in today's study session.
Our next speaker, Dr. Shane Snyder, has a bachelor's degree in chemistry from Thiel College in Pennsylvania and a doctorate in environmental toxicology from Michigan State University. He is also an adjunct professor at the University of Nevada in Las Vegas. He is the research and development project manager for the Southern Nevada Water Authority. SNWA supplies potable water to the greater Las Vegas area from Lake Mead. They also operate a tertiary treatment plant that discharges recycled water to Lake Mead. Dr. Snyder was hired about 10 years ago to initiate a program or continue a program to study emerging compounds. So his agency is a user of water that contains recycled water. They are a discharger of recycled water, and there are 25 million users of that water downstream of in the Colorado River. They take this issue quite seriously. Dr. Snyder and his wife, who is also a toxicologist, and their son, who's 10 months old and not yet a toxicologist, live in Las Vegas and drink the water there. He's been working on this topic in Las Vegas and around the nation for 10 years, and he's the principal investigator on 5 national studies on this topic, nationally funded studies, including an evaluation of the toxicological relevance and of endocrine disruptors and pharmaceuticals in drinking water, funded by the premier drinking water quality research organization, American Water Works Association Research Foundation. Likewise, another AWARF study that he is principal investigator of is a conventional and advanced treatment technologies for the removal of these kinds of compounds. He's also an advisor to the federal government on the analytical procedures for detecting and measuring the concentration of these compounds.
I appreciate the opportunity to be here with your group, and I echo what the past speaker said about being proactive. I think it's impressive that you're taking the time to hear about this topic. And I want to make it clear, too, that our agency has a research division, of which I'm the project manager, and we have a group of students, including PhD students from California and postdocs from around the world. And our group is independent of the political decision-making that happens in Las Vegas. So I'm going to tell you the history of what we've experienced and have learned about and the research we've done, but understand that the decision-making of how the city reacts is done by a different group. So we really are an independent research group, heavily externally funded. About 80% of our funding is from competitive research grants, and so we'll go through this, and I'll tell you a little bit about what we've done and what the city's done so far.
Thank you.
So first of all, this is kind of, again, repetitive a bit, but I think this is interesting to see this journal. This is the Journal of the American Water Works Association, and they're talking about emerging issues like viruses and algal toxins, but the picture's kind of interesting. They have milk and cheese and some beer. I think it's missing some Sonoma wine, but, you know, other than that, it looks pretty good. So what are some of these chemicals? Well, we know that there's probably 3 main categories. Things that have been more recently identified and shown to be an issue, like perchlorate or nitrosamines, like a byproduct. Things that have been found to be more toxic than we may have initially thought, like bromate, disinfection byproduct, or arsenic, where the MCL has changed in the last year. And the one that I'm going to talk primarily about is the endocrine disruptors that you've heard about, and some of these pharmaceuticals and personal care products as well. So this is the structure of 17-beta estradiol. Now, this is the estrogen that's in all of us, men, women, cats, dogs, all animals have this primary estrogen. And one of the big issues is that some synthetic chemicals, like octophenol, which is from a detergent, have a similar molecular geometry. They're different, but you can see they have a similar structure. And so this chemical can mimic the natural estrogen, albeit at orders of magnitude, 100,000 times difference in the amount that it takes to get the same effect, but it can do it, there's no doubt about it. And when I started as a researcher at Michigan State looking at Lake Mead, this was the compound that we thought, we were sure that that compound was causing any of the effects that may have been seen in fish, and we were wrong, and I'll show you how we found out. So what about these steroid hormones? Well, clearly it must be a new issue, right? Well, it's not. Not at all. In fact, this paper, you can't see it, unfortunately. This is from November of 1965, published by Harvard University in the United States. Biodegradation of steroid hormones. I took a couple captions I find interesting. Look at the history. Hormones in wastewater. Steroid hormones generally find their way into wastewater and with them into natural and surface waters. 1965. Further along in this document, in this publication, it was a peer-reviewed publication, says nevertheless, it's our responsibility to find out how hormones may get into drinking water under various conditions. So again, it's 1965. So we have 42 years have passed, and now all of a sudden, this is a mainstream issue. Everybody's up in arms about it. But let's take a look back at history and see what's happened. In 1948, one of the first papers looked at the effects on amphibians. A past speaker mentioned atrazine and how amphibians metamorphosize. That endpoint, that ability of chemicals to do that has been known for decades. No question about it. 1970, the U.S. Department of the Interior studied steroids and also looked at how steroids can move through a wastewater treatment plant. And in 1977, the very first publication in the world was done in the United States by the University of Kansas and looked at pharmaceuticals and said that perhaps someday this will become a big of interest. But it sat dormant because we had other things to worry about at the time, I believe. There's a lot of worries of DDT and different chemicals that were being applied to widespread. So in the United States, the first place ever to see these impacts that I know of in fish was in Lake Mead. Lake Mead is the receiving body of all the water that comes out of Las Vegas. It's also fed 97% by the Colorado River coming through the Grand Canyon. And this paper was from 1992, data from 1992 and 1995. So Jean showed the data from the reference to John Sumter in the United Kingdom in 95. This was happening in the U.S. too. And as this was happening, we had no points of reference. There was no USGS study. There was no good documentation on what we were to expect. And so the city of Las Vegas funded what became one of the larger studies undertaken to try to find out what was going on. So we had no idea then. Really weren't sure what was happening. And so they contracted with my advisor at Michigan State, and I had the great assignment of being reassigned from Michigan to Las Vegas, which was acceptable. So if you look at our city, it's lying here in a valley surrounded by mountains. All the water from Las Vegas drains into the central drainage point and enters Lake Mead through the Las Vegas Bay. The Grand Canyon's here and the water's coming in this way from the Colorado over the Hoover Dam and down the Colorado River system. Las Vegas has three wastewater treatment plants producing a total of about 250 million gallons per day. For every liter of water returned to Lake Mead, the Water Authority may draw another liter out. In other words, 100% of all the water is reused. Of course, it's mixed into the lake with, again, 97% of the water coming from the Colorado River system. And just to put it in perspective, and another point I wanted to make, what happens in Vegas, of course, doesn't always stay in Vegas. That's not true. But also, our scenario may not be directly applicable to your location. I want to make that clear. I'm not trying to say that. I'm trying to show you what we've done and what we've learned. So in our valley, our population now has reached about 2 million. We're expecting it to reach 4 million. So it's a rapidly growing, the fastest growing city in the nation. On top of that, we have about 40 million people that come to our city each year and bring along with them their pharmaceuticals and their personal care products. We're very dry. We get less than 4 inches of rain and over 6 feet of evaporation. And for us, reuse is critical. That's it. Our city cannot sustain without reusing the water. The water that comes out of the from the Colorado River and through Lake Mead supply water for more than 22 million people. It's a large percentage of our population. Now, this picture is actually a eutrophication event where the algae had taken over. But I want to make it clear that algae bloom wasn't due to the wastewater treatment plants specifically. It was tied to sediments and the drought in the Colorado. Right now, we're going through what is an epic drought, and the sediments are being resuspended. The lake is now about 90 feet low. And some of this drought has been attributed to global warming. In fact, our general manager was on the Today Show and on NBC Nightly News just 2 weeks ago. So this is water is really a critical issue for us, obviously. So back to the history. 1996, this was in the Las Vegas Sun, one of our larger newspapers, and talking about the fact that they did find impacts to the carp, to the fish, in the original study. And then in 1996, the study that I was heading up, we started looking at what was causing the effects, or what did we think was responsible if we could narrow it down. Now, one of the important points here, as Dr. DeBrew mentioned, the vitellogenin, this is a biomarker. It was found elevated in this area of the Las Vegas Bay. But what's also interesting, that part of that bay is the most productive fishery in the entire water system. There are more fish, more variety of fish, and more of the endangered species of fish than anywhere else in the entire Colorado River system. The fish like the wastewater, and they need the nutrients. But one of the things that we found was that, contrary to our hypothesis of being synthetic chemicals, it looked like the most estrogenic chemicals were really steroids. And so both natural ones that we all have and also synthetic from various pharmaceuticals. Sorry, I'm speaking not loud enough, I guess. So when we began to release these data in 1997, again, this was in the absence of almost any other studies in the nation, other than the ones from the 60s that we didn't know about. We only knew those later as we did a lit review to look into it deeper. This magazine, this article, is from 1999. Again, this is based on the study that we were conducting at Michigan State. This is actually me scuba diving and my wife capturing fish that we had caged. We purchased fish from a controlled setting, placed them in various points in the lake to study what was the impact of the wastewater on the fish. And again, looking at also now starting to look at pharmaceuticals. After we released this study, of course, in the newspaper, we saw that the pharmaceuticals were of interest, and the story came out in October of 2000. And again, remember, this is 7 years ago or 6.5 years ago. So I'm going back to this to show you an interesting picture of what's happened. Again, three of the wastewater treatment plants, about 1.2, jumping into metrics, cubic meters per day. If we take a transect and we look from here to Hoover Dam, and we pretend this is straight, our agency for the past 7 years has done intense sampling along this transect at different depths of the lake. And this is just showing one picture. Meprobamate is a pharmaceutical. It's an anti-anxiety medication. This is the wastewater coming in, and this is the Hoover Dam. So you can certainly see it coming in. The units here are nanograms per liter, parts per trillion, 10 to the minus 9. We can also see one antibiotic. We see it coming in, also degrading quickly on the surface because it's degraded by sunlight. In fact, if you get this medication, they'll tell you don't go into the sunlight because it's so photodegradable. Our agency is working on two large projects. One is to move the wastewater so it doesn't continue this direction, but rather it comes here and then is injected into the lake closer to the dam. The reason for this project is because of nutrients. It's actually related to TMDLs of nutrients. It's not related to the EDCs. We also have a new intake for drinking water that we're moving up to here, and the reason is depth. The lake has dropped 100 feet. If it drops much lower, we'll be pulling air. So we're digging our intakes. The cost of these two projects is on the order of $1.5 billion, maybe a bit more than that. But in the whole mix of all the water and the endocrine disruptors lies this fish. This is a razorback sucker. This is an endangered species of fish. And this fish once enjoyed the vibrant waters of the Colorado. It likes high aerated water, the rapids that were in the Colorado. What destroyed this fish was habitat destruction. The Hoover Dam, the Glen Canyon Dam, the Morales Dam. Its habitat is essentially gone. And one of the only places that it's actively breeding, actively recruiting, is in our wastewater, in the effluent. So, in the environmental impact statements to look at how we move our wastewater around, one of the things that we were told is, you cannot take all your wastewater from this discharge point or you will destroy the endangered species. So we have to leave the wastewater, but try to leave the EDCs behind. It's a very delicate balance. It's a really unique story of what's happening. In support of that, in 2000, our agency created a research and development division, and we began looking at how we can measure these chemicals. That was the first real challenge. How can you accurately measure 10 to the minus ninth of a gram? And if you want to know how challenging it is, look no further than the 2002 reference from Colpin et al., the USGS study, the very famous study. Those data for birth control and for estrogen, some of those data had to be retracted from the journal because they were wrong. Analytically, they were incorrect. And this is one of the best groups of chemists in the world, so it's very, very difficult. And I think in our 2003 paper, we're very clear at how difficult it can be. The point here is, too, is to make that we don't have standardized methods. There are no EPA methods. There are no certifications our lab can get for EDC analysis. And frankly, a lot of the data out there is poor. There's a lot of bad data. It's very difficult. And we've gotten closer to it, I believe, is our newest paper, but it is quite costly. It's a large investment to do this. As far as the treatment, I've already taken up quite a bit of time, so I'm not going to go into the treatment end of it, but just to say that we've looked closely at how we could treat and what our options would be. I think the important point to make is that there is no treatment process in the world that can remove these chemicals to less than detection. Of the best analytical chemists, you will never get there because they're too good. The analytical chemistry is outpacing the ability to treat, and it's outpacing the toxicology. So there are certainly going to be innovations in treatment. There's no doubt about it, and better. But to say we can remove everything till it's gone and doesn't exist is an impossibility. Now, kind of jumping backwards, looking at endocrine disruption specifically, the EPA did define it and said that this is essentially, I'll paraphrase, to say that anything that's exogenous or outside the body that can cause an impact on various endpoints can be considered an endocrine-disrupting chemical. I like the World Health Organization, and this is 5 years newer, 2002. The World Health Organization said that it's a substance or a mixture that can have an adverse effect in an intact organism. They said that specifically because there was a lot of work with cell lines. A lot of work that I did was with genetically engineered cells. So they took this and said it has to be adverse and it has to be in a real entire organism. I don't want to go through this and just kind of flash it up there and mention that there is a candidate contaminant list. I've been on the past two expert panels. I was in Washington 3 weeks ago for this, where we looked at chemicals. We looked at a lot of pharmaceuticals and steroids. Now, I can't go into detail on what's going to come out because that's confidential, but I can tell you it's been looked at, and I wouldn't expect any regs soon for drinking water on pharmaceuticals or endocrine disruptors. The final list will probably be published in early 2008. There is an unregulated contaminant rule, and it affects large systems serving more than 10,000 people, and you can look at that and get a feeling for some of the unregulated chemicals. But the real discussions on the 1996 amendment to the Safe Drinking Water Act, where the US EPA was mandated to develop a screening program. This is underway. I mean, this is we've spent quite a bit of time working on this. They looked at things that can mimic estrogen or block estrogen, mimic testosterone or block testosterone, and look at things that impact the thyroid gland, and known conveniently as the EAT endpoints. So this is what this program looks like. And as I mentioned before, I spent, I think, about 5 or 6 years on the Federal Advisory Committee for this program, where we were developing the Tier 1 and Tier 2 screenings. It's going to take a lot of time, but the EPA is working through this. They're working through how can we tell if a chemical is an endocrine disruptor or not. We can't say that now. There's no finite way to determine if a chemical is an endocrine disruptor until this methodology has been shown to be robust and reproducible. And so far, many of the bioassays have been employed are not reproducible. Four different labs get four different results. So there's a lot of ambiguity and a lot that's going into standardizing this. And one of the grants that our agency applied for and we received was funding to, let's take a look. In the absence of federal regulations, what can we say about human health? Because that was our primary concern for our agency, is to find out what the reference dose or what would be the threshold for effects. And just to start out, I mean, the real fundamental of all toxicology, no substance is a poison by itself, it's the dose. That holds true for water. Pure water, if you drink enough of it, will kill you. So anything, any chemical can be deadly if you expose to too much of it. We really do need to get towards what the real risk is. Pharmaceuticals, no doubt, have improved human life and expanded our life expectancy. They are designed to have a biological endpoint. Some are designed to be toxic, to kill cells, like to stop cancer. And they're all potentially toxic depending on the dose. So for our group, the first problem we have is which pharmaceuticals do we study? There are over 3,000 prescription drugs. So we looked at what are the most used. Then of the ones that are most used, which ones have the most toxicity? We included that representatives from various drug groups. We also gauged publications or what was the interest from non-government organizations. And then we looked at the final candidates. We looked at about 20, which is about all we could afford to do because the risk assessment was quite expensive. So here are the chemicals that the main ones that we decided to study. I really don't want to read through them all, but you can see the generic name, the brand names, and some of these are probably going to be familiar, like Lipitor or Valium, and so on and so forth. They have various types of endpoints that they're used for. And then I have the ranking in 2003 of how widely prescribed. So this Lipitor was the number one most prescribed drug in the United States in 2003. So what we did, we didn't just look at the therapeutic endpoint. We looked at side effects. We looked at the most toxic endpoint these pharmaceuticals had in clinical trials. And sometimes it was pregnancy. Some pharmaceuticals you don't want to have them exposed to women when they're pregnant, whereas for a man it's fine. So we looked at the most sensitive endpoint. Often the most sensitive endpoint, believe it or not, is carcinogenicity, where the risk of carcinogenicity outweighs the therapeutic value. And that decision's made by the FDA. We also looked at chemicals that were detected previously by the USGS or by our own studies that we've done over the past 10 years. Now with the EDCs, picking the EDCs was much, much harder because there's so much variance in the definition. So there's hundreds of compounds we could have looked at. The bottom line is that we tried to pick chemicals where someone had shown an impact in an animal, not just a cell line, not just a theoretical impact, but a true adverse effect in a mammal. So what are some of the endocrine disruptors? Well, these could be natural chemicals, such as hormones, like the hormones we talked about that we all have. It could be food products, like soy has quite a bit of phytoestrogen, and various plants. Certainly, no doubt about it, can be anthropogenic, like plasticizers or pesticides, pharmaceuticals, and also combustion byproducts. And the combustion byproducts is an important one because we do a lot of combustion to make electricity. So I want you to think about that as we get through this. EDCs that we picked for risk assessment, atrazine, clearly one of great interest. Bisphenol A and phthalates, another pesticide. And I don't want to go through all these, but a lot of pesticides and alkylphenols. We judged these by the Global Water Research Coalition, the Endocrine Disruptor Screening Program, international groups, and California DHS was also a large weighed in on our decision making. So when we looked for the toxicology of the pharmaceuticals, there's actually quite a bit of data. There's more mammalian tox data for pharmaceuticals than there is for almost any environmental contaminant, because there's human data. There are clinical trials. So we were able to go through and look at what's been done and the data that's been generated. There's not a lot known about metabolites or long-term exposures to non-target populations, which is exactly why we looked at side effect data. And sometimes the data is hard to get. Often it's proprietary or grandfathered. I don't want to go into a lot of detail, but I thought I'd show you how do we come up with a number. And this, by the way, is EPA paradigm. This is how the Environmental Protection Agency would build a regulation generally for Safe Drinking Water Act. So this is talking about a no adverse effect or the lowest adverse observed effect. So basically, in this case, simvastatin, an anti-lipidemic pharmaceutical, and they dosed rats at various concentrations. So at some dose, they saw no effect. They gave the animal the chemical, they saw no effect, and that becomes the no adverse effect. In this case, it was 6.25. And then the first dose at which they see an effect becomes the lowest observed. And in that range, they prefer to have this one, this number, but often it's only this number. So we calculate out what we call an acceptable daily intake, or an ADI. So what does that mean? And what does that mean as far as the data I'm about to show you? It's not a public health goal. It's not a reference dose. It's not a policy statement. And it's not even a recommended public health goal. This is straight up toxicology. This is the number you get when you plug in EPA risk assessment paradigm. So we built this to facilitate discussions, to begin to look at what would regulations look like in drinking water. So if we have this no L or low L value, we then put what we call uncertainty factors. Many people call this a safety factor. But we add to whatever this lowest dose is, numbers to divide by. So we look at uncertainty, variability, extrapolation, and at the end you end up getting a value. And this is a better way to look at it. This is graphically. So this is the value at which they saw no observed adverse effects in an animal. Then we divide by tenfold to go from an animal to a human. Then by three, for instance, to go from a normal human to a sensitive human, like a child, like a juvenile or a pregnant mother. Then we divide by 10 again, just for database uncertainties. So you get very large safety factors built into these numbers. Once we have the ADI, we then have to calculate that back to drinking water. And the standard way to do that is to assume that a person will drink about 2 liters of water a day, and that the average person is 60 kilograms. And so you do the math, you end up with the drinking water equivalent level. And then for carcinogens, the word acceptable is probably bad, an increased cancer risk of 1 in 1 million. So it's based on 1 in 1 million cancer risk over a 30-year period. And so you do this math and you come up with a number. And generally this is what you use in an MCL determination, maximum contaminant limit. The next thing you have to know is how much is there. How much is in the water? This is to get to the risk assessment. So now we know the toxicity. What's in the drinking water? We looked at 23 drinking water treatment plants across the United States. And I can say that your group is one of the first groups to see this. A few people have seen this before, but this is the frequency. So up around, this is the 50th percentile. And we see dilantin, which is a pharmaceutical. These two are pharmaceuticals, atrazine, the herbicide, 2, 3, 4, 5 more pharmaceuticals. The first steroid, and then flame retardants, and so on. When we go to finished water, now this is after treatment, and we're not differentiating at this point what type of treatment. Most of these are conventional, chlorination, filtration, coagulation. You see the number distribution change, and now atrazine becomes the number one, and we still see some of the pharmaceuticals, and these are all chemicals that are resistant to chlorination, because most waters in the United States that we've studied have some type of secondary disinfection. This is just showing you a couple of chemicals that we looked at and raw and finished water from three example facilities. And the point is that some chemicals we can detect in the raw by the time they're treated are quickly gone. Other chemicals, there's very little treatment. And again, the differences depend on the treatment, type of treatment, or the technology that's used. So another important point for us was to look at intentional reuse versus unintentional. This is three drinking water facilities from the United States that we knew were impacted by wastewater in one way or another. And you can see some pharmaceuticals, another pharmaceutical. You can see atrazine again. And again, this is just an ambient drinking water from the United States, finished drinking water. These three are reuse waters from indirect potable reuse, so an IPR system. And what you see is that in many cases, this water actually has less contamination than the drinking water, the ambient drinking water in the country. And we've seen that time and time again, based upon the treatment technology. Another thing to point your attention to is the units. Now we're at 0.25 nanograms. So now we're getting down to 10 to the minus 10th and 10 to the minus 12th. We're getting into extremely minute concentrations. So after all those slides, this is the one that tells the final story of the toxicology for these pharmaceuticals. Here's the toxic effect. Now I think it's interesting again to notice that often these endpoints were not the therapeutic endpoint. In other words, the cancer endpoint was more sensitive for carbamazepine than its endpoint of being an anti-anxiety medicine. If we look at the ADI that we calculated from the formulas I showed you before, we come up with the dwell. Now, I did you a disservice to convert this into micrograms. So we've jumped units. Now we're at micrograms. So if you want to look at it back as nanograms, you have to multiply it by 1,000. I did this so that we could fit this column on. This is the margin of exposure. So this is the maximum concentration we ever detected in the worst drinking water plant in the nation. And this is the safety factor, essentially. And what this is saying is that the amount to cause and effect with safety factors versus the amount detected in drinking water are thousands and thousands of times off. Literally, you'd have to consume somewhere between 1,000 liters to several million liters to hit this reference dose. So what about the endocrine disruptors? We've addressed the pharmaceuticals. We're still in the process of calculating those dwells for the EDCs we chose, and I can't show them today, but what I can show you are some of the recent guidelines. This is the World Health Organization, 2002, saying that from the data that we have so far, there's lack of firm evidence between low-level impacts and adverse effects to humans from endocrine disruptors. The Water Environment Research Foundation made a couple of statements in a 2005 technical brief, also stating that no studies have shown causality between low levels of EDCs in wastewater and adverse to humans. And this one says essentially the same thing. So the final part, after this long whirlwind presentation, is a little bit of comparative risk. And this one's kind of just fascinating. One of the stories we hear a lot about is that human sperm counts are declining in certain developed nations, supposedly due to exposure to various chemicals. It may be related to natural plant estrogens, especially since soy really wasn't heavy in the North American diet until the last 20 years, where it's come up very quickly. According to Dr. Professor Steve Safe at Texas A&M University, the amount of natural estrogen we're exposed to is about 40 million times that of any synthetics in the diet. An interesting example, the cheetahs at the Cincinnati Zoo, they had a very prosperous captive breeding program, and then the program began to fail, and they wondered why. What happened to our cheetahs? They can't breed anymore. It was their diet, and it was soy in their diet that caused that lack of reproduction. Even in the studies on which I was the FACA member, we were looking at bisphenol A, for instance, and we found that the diet fed by the National Institute of Health had so much phytoestrogen, you couldn't see the impact of the chemical. So the diet really, truly is important. If we look at where they come from, alfalfa and soy again, citrus, red clover. There's no grapes listed here, so that's good news. But we see estrogenicity decreasing. But structurally, this is our natural estrogen again. And this is just one. In fact, this one is this one, one of the less powerful, but you can see structurally they have some similarity. So what happens when we start to look at how this compares? So one of the things that I talked about earlier was using cell bioassays to test wastewater. We look at this, and this is some of the studies published around the world now, and this was actually the subject of my PhD thesis, so it's near and dear to my heart. But we looked at raw wastewater using a cell bioassay for estrogen, and we saw quite a bit of estrogenicity. This level is quite high. This is in nanograms per liter, raw wastewater. When you look at three plants, we look at the effluent, you can see it drops quite a bit, actually getting pretty low. This one's still relatively high. We look at drinking water. This is right at the limit of detection. This number probably isn't even real. It's right at the limit. We saw this is the only plant of 23 we saw any hit at all, and even then, right at the limit. What about soy sauce? If we look at four brands of soy sauce and we compare this number, comparing these in nanograms per liter. Now, in this case, this wasn't even a whole liter. This was the recommended serving size. You can see that the estrogenicity in the bioassay that's used around the nation is much, much higher than raw wastewater. So a serving of soy sauce would be equivalent to drinking a liter of raw wastewater, or maybe 10 liters or so of wastewater effluent from a secondary system. It's not just soy. Look at green tea, and I apologize for these brand names. I shouldn't have had them on there, but if we looked at human steroids too, just to make sure it wasn't an analytical anomaly, and we don't see any at the limited detection. But phytoestrogens, now we're into different units. Now we're up into parts per billion, the estrogenicity being about the same as a wastewater of a primary wastewater treatment plant's effluent. Vegetable juice, we're up now into the parts per million, verging on it. Same thing, relatively high levels of estrogenicity. And one of the most amazing ones is looking at dairy products. Look at cow milk. Now, these are three brands of cow milk. You see they all have pretty much the same estradiol, but these are 60 parts per trillion. It's about 1,000 times more than some of the wastewater effluents we've looked at. And progesterone especially, extremely high levels. Some testosterone. And this makes sense. This is an animal's milk producing from the mammary glands. We'd expect this. We also saw phytoestrogens, albeit at low levels. The total estrogenicity was actually quite low because the milk has the ability to sequester some of it. But nonetheless, these levels were much higher than anything we've ever seen in wastewater. The World Health Organization, again, has done tremendous work and probably one of the most reputable international agencies. And in 2005, they looked at chemicals in food. How much of a chemical can be in food and be safe? They actually looked at 17-beta-estradiol, the powerful natural steroid we keep talking about. And they came up with their own ADI, and it looks like a very small number. But let's calculate this back. Let's put it into the units that we're looking at. This would convert out to 3,500 nanograms per 70-kilogram person. You'd have to drink 1,500 to 2,000 liters of wastewater to get to this number. Very, very high. Another controversy that I think we need to think about. Triclosan. This chemical has drawn immense press. Even in Las Vegas, it's detectable in wastewater, rarely detectable in drinking water. But this fellow from Colgate won an award as being a hero of chemistry for putting it in toothpaste at percentages. Not parts per trillion, not parts per million, percent. So why are we giving somebody an award for putting it in toothpaste but worried about spending public dollars to treat the last nanogram of that chemical? It's confusing. So in closing, if we start to drop our detection limits, and we will, and we are, to picograms or femtograms or attograms, 10 to the minus 12th, 15th, 17th, what are we going to see? EDCs and pharmaceuticals are being viewed differently than any other chemical. Arsenic. Nobody would say arsenic has to be zero, non-detectable, because you couldn't do it. It's one of the most abundant elements in the Earth's crust. But yet we come up with a level that's safe. And I think we're going to have to do that because of our analytical detection abilities. The precautionary principle is important, no doubt about it. Popular Science, 1963, showing acceptable disposal of motor oil. Well, clearly, we know that no longer is this an acceptable way to dispose of our used motor oil. Absolutely no doubt. But have we at what limit can we push this to? We're at a point where we can detect a fraction of a fingerprint, where people have to wear special suits to go in a room to get a blank. What level does precautionary principle become overwhelming? Analytically, we can detect anything. This is actually atoms. These are atoms of iodine sitting on a copper plate. Theoretically, we could detect one molecule of any chemical. So it's interesting chemistry. The relevance is really kind of up in the air. It doesn't appear to be human health related. The bottom line is there's no such thing as zero. It doesn't exist. Zero is a theoretical number. We can get down to the limit of detection, but as that limit drops, the treatment you put in today won't be zero tomorrow. And Einstein said, not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts can be counted. And I think in our field, there's no truer statement. So take home thoughts. Just because we don't detect something doesn't mean it's safe. In other words, you can spend all the money you want on analyses. Maybe you don't detect anything. That still doesn't mean it's safe. But conversely, just because it's safe doesn't mean it's non-detectable. And non-detectable doesn't equal zero. So all these things are important. If we look at the public perception, if EDCs are a human health issue, then food will be by far, by thousands, maybe millions of times more exposure than water. The pharmaceuticals in water are not likely to pose any human health risk. There's a tremendous data of health effects on pharmaceuticals. And the amount of the ADIs are orders of magnitude higher than anything that's ever been detected. So if perception is the only tangible issue we have, how are we going to deal with the better instrumentation that comes out every year, better and better, sensitive and more sensitive? There's no silver bullet at all. Oxidation with chlorine or ozone, you form some kinds of byproducts. If we use membrane technology, we form brine. If we use carbon, then we have to dispose of the carbon, landfill it, or regenerate it. And this is the big one to me. Every process we use will use electricity. That electricity will cause environmental problems. It can produce them. Now, there's green energy technology, and I'm all for it, and where our agency is installing solar panels. But the point is, if we go into high energy intensive processes to get rid of the last nanogram of caffeine, how much do we cause global warming by producing gases that are given off by the energy generation? So it's just important to remember the whole cycle, not just one cycle. Source water protection is clearly the key. We can protect the ecosystem, we can protect our drinking water, and we can prevent dilution. So that was long, it was whirlwind, but I'm happy to take any questions when we have time, and certainly if you want to see any more data, you can email me or any of our team, and we're more than delighted to share. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Snyder.
The next speaker is Laura Kennedy. Laura is from the firm of Kennedy Jenks. She has a bachelor's degree from Dartmouth College and a master's degree in toxicology from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT. Her area of expertise is in the area of human health and ecological risk assessment, and she has performed risk assessments for particular environmental and public works projects using EPA methodologies and other methodologies. She has come to some of the same conclusions that Dr. Snyder has, she will describe to us her results of some risk assessments, since some of her results are consistent with Dr. Snyder's, that I'm sure she'll be able to move through her material fairly quickly.
What I do want to quickly go through is just sort of an introduction to risk assessment, since that is what I do. Just want to make sure people are brought up to speed quickly. Give some quick discussions about risks from recycled water specifically, and then present three ways of evaluating risks from recycled water, at least three ways I've looked at, and that's looking at comparison with drinking water, looking at therapeutic doses and other sources of risk. Oh, sorry. So first, risk assessment is a quantitative approach to coming up with a number to say what is the risk. And you really do this so that you can make risk management decisions. Once you know what the risk is, you then can weigh what risks are you willing to accept, which risks do you not want to accept, and also how does one risk compare to another. To do this, there are methods that have been established by the US EPA as well as many states, including California. Risk assessment has been the basis of numerous environmental regulations since the mid-80s. In fact, many of the regulatory guidelines that we have for food, air, and water are all based on risk assessment. The fundamental basics of risk assessment is that risk is a function of exposure and toxicity, as Dr. Snyder mentioned. What this really means is that exposure alone does not equal risk. You need to have exposure, and whatever you are exposed to needs to be toxic. If the exposure is sufficiently low or if the toxicity is sufficiently low, there really is not a significant risk. And so this really gets into looking at the concentration that's in whatever media you are exposed to, how you are exposed to that media, and then the toxicity or the dose response of the compound in that media. So when you look at risk assessment, you need to consider how you are exposed. And it's important to think about the environment we live in. Chemicals in the environment move into air, they move into soil, they move into water. And through that, we can breathe the air, we can drink the water, we can eat the food, we can inhale the dust in our homes. And so there's multiple routes of exposure, and all of those routes need to be considered when you're looking at risk, especially when you're looking at environmental risks. When it actually gets to quantifying risk, there's actually fairly simple equations that are used, and there's just a few inputs that you need. So one is you would need to know what the concentration is, and there's very good occurrence data for recycled water that can be used. We need to make assumptions about what level of intake occurs, and this would be how much water do you drink, how often do you swim in water, how often do you take showers. And that would get to the days per year that you were exposed. You would also want to know how much water do you take up, or how much chemical in the water is taken up through your skin. That would be the dermal absorption. And in the case of recycled water, where you may not be intentionally drinking it, you could still get incidental ingestion from, say, when you're in a playground and there's water on the grass, a child might pick up the grass and eat that. So you can make assumptions, and typically in risk assessment, you make very conservative assumptions. The purpose of risk assessment is to protect the most highly exposed individuals. And so you think about the sensitive populations, and typically the exposure values you use are much higher than the average exposures. And then same thing with the toxicity data. You would look at the dose response data or the effect thresholds. And then, as Dr. Snyder mentioned, typically these have uncertainty factors applied to them. So these are thousands of times lower than effects that are actually observed in lab studies. And sometimes they're thousands of times lower than doses that actually don't cause effects in lab studies. So getting on to recycled water more specifically, there are three different exposure scenarios that we've looked at when we've been looking at risk from recycled water. And those scenarios that we've considered are for an agricultural use of water, in which case you might have an agricultural worker that is exposed to the recycled water. You could have cases of urban irrigation or landscape irrigation, in which case you might have playground users that get exposed to the recycled water. These could be either adult or children. And then finally, in the case of recreational impoundment, you could have the recycled water being used in a water body used for swimming. And in that case, you could have recreational swimmers being exposed to the recycled water. And again, you can have adults or children being exposed. And we've looked at all of those different exposure scenarios, assuming that we're using disinfected tertiary treated wastewater as the recycled water. And in all cases, we're assuming that the people are exposed to 100% of the recycled water, meaning that there's no dilution or any of that occurring. And we've looked at these risks for a variety of pharmaceuticals. These are just some examples. Most of these, I'm sure everyone is aware of: Advil, Aleve, Tylenol, Lipressor, Cipro, and then ethinyl estradiol, or birth control pills. And these concentrations are consistent with what everyone's been talking about. These are concentrations that are in nanograms per liter, parts per trillion. And that's what we've been using as our exposure concentration when we do risk assessment. So going back to those three different scenarios where we're talking about an agricultural worker, a playground user, or a recreational swimmer, you can calculate the intakes, making some very conservative assumptions about what types of exposure might occur. And what we have found is that the highest intake actually will occur for a recreational swimmer. Again, this is assuming that you're swimming in 100% recycled water. But what's important to note here is that the intakes are in milligrams per kilogram per day. That's a typical unit that's used in toxicology, risk assessment, and pharmacology. Doses often are prescribed in milligrams. These intakes are significantly low. Actually, if you remember back in Dr. Snyder's presentation, he had an example of a NOEL, and the NOEL was 6 milligrams per kilogram per day for a rat study. So these intakes are much lower than doses typically observed in lab studies. And so I really wanted to get on to what does this mean when you're looking at recycled water, specifically when you're looking at pharmaceuticals and personal care products in recycled water? And what is the risk, and what do those risks mean? Because just because something is there doesn't mean it poses a risk. And just because it poses a risk, it doesn't mean that that risk is significant. And that's really where the relative risk assessment comes in, is a way to look at risks in the context of other risks. And you need to do this because chemicals are ubiquitous in the environment. We can't avoid risk from chemicals. They are everywhere. So what we need to understand is what chemicals pose the most significant risks and what pathways pose the most significant risks in order to understand what risks may or may not be significant. And one way to do that is look at how risks from recycled water or pharmaceuticals specifically in personal care products compare to other chemicals. We may also want to look at how the risks compare to other health effects or the intakes compare to other health effects, such as a therapeutic dose. And then finally, since this is an environment filled with chemicals, what other sources of risk do we have in our lives? So one way to look at this is to think about regulated chemicals in drinking water. As has been mentioned several times today, pharmaceuticals and personal care products are not regulated. There are no regulatory criteria to point to and say this is an acceptable level. But there are many chemicals that are regulated, and there are many chemicals that you can say there is a level that is considered acceptable to be exposed to. EPA and Cal DHS sets maximum contaminant levels for chemicals in drinking water, and these are called MCLs. We can look at the intake of pharmaceuticals and personal care products in recycled water relative to the intakes that we would get from a regulated chemical in drinking water. And what we have found is that if you are exposed to chemicals in drinking water at the MCL, again, this is at the level that's considered acceptable by Cal DHS, and by the US EPA, that those intakes are orders of magnitude higher than the intakes we see from pharmaceuticals or personal care products in recycled water. And again, this is assuming a worst case for recycled water, so this would be the recreational swimmer exposed to 100% recycled water. Couple things to note here. The intakes, again, in milligrams per kilogram per day. And as you'll see, with drinking water, these are all well below 1 milligram per kilogram per day. I believe that our drinking water is excellent. I'm not criticizing the drinking water. I'm not saying chemicals in drinking water are bad. These are very, very low intakes for drinking water. But the pharmaceuticals and personal care products and recycled water are even lower. The other thing to note is that the axis is on a log scale, meaning each of those lines represents an order of 10. And so in the case of recycled water, these are thousands to millions of times lower, not just slightly lower, but millions of times lower than the intakes in drinking water. A key point, the chemicals that are regulated in drinking water have known adverse health effects and no therapeutic uses. These are chemicals that are on the Proposition 65 list, meaning these are chemicals that are known to cause cancer, are known to be reproductive toxins. And again, what we are allowed to be exposed to in our drinking water is orders of magnitude higher then what type of exposure could occur from to pharmaceuticals or personal care products in recycled water? Another way of looking at pharmaceuticals and personal care products is comparing the intake to a therapeutic dose. And as Dr. Snyder mentioned, a therapeutic dose may not be the worst case, but it does provide context. There may be people that shouldn't be exposed at the therapeutic dose, but it does provide a context for the level of exposure that occurs. Now, these approved therapeutic doses, or these therapeutic doses are approved by the US FDA. And what we have done is we've looked at a single dose of these pharmaceuticals. And so that would mean if you took a single pill of ibuprofen, you would receive a dose of 200 milligrams. We've also looked at the cumulative dose that would occur over an entire exposure duration, meaning if you're an agricultural worker, it is assumed that you perform your duties and are exposed to recycled water for 25 years. The dose that you would receive over 25 years working in the field where recycled water is used is, again, orders of magnitude less than what you would get from a single pill of Advil. Same thing with playground users and recreational swimmers. If you look at the exposure that would occur over the entire time that you are exposed, you still will not receive a single one-time dose of any of these compounds. So what this really shows is that the cumulative doses from recycled water are lower than the approved doses from a single use of pharmaceuticals. And in general, typically, therapeutic doses are not associated with adverse health effects for the majority of the population. And then finally, something that is really important to consider, this is getting back to chemicals being ubiquitous, is that there are other sources of chemicals risk. For example, in our food, there's mercury and PCBs in fish, there are dioxins in meat and dairy, there are pesticides in produce. The US FDA monitors food, these data are widely available, and chemicals are present in our food source. In addition, there's chemicals present in our air. Many of these compounds actually are not very water soluble. They will preferentially partition to soil, and as a result, many of these compounds actually are fairly significant in indoor dust. PBDEs, which are flame retardants, one of the most significant routes of exposure is actually to dust in indoor air because they are not very water soluble. Another example would be volatile chemicals. I live in the Bay Area. Air quality is always an issue. Benzene is present in the air we breathe because we drive our cars. So given all of these different routes of exposure, there are average daily intakes that have been estimated for several chemicals, di-2-ethylhexylphthalate, DDT, PCBs, PBDEs. All of these compounds are known to cause cancer. They are all known to have other adverse effects. And these are the average daily intakes that we receive in the U.S. through all routes of exposure, through food, through water, through air. And what I want to emphasize here is that the average daily intakes that we receive of these chemicals, which are fairly nasty chemicals, to be honest, are still thousands to millions of times higher than the intakes from pharmaceuticals and personal care products in recycled water. So in summary, I feel very strongly that risks from pharmaceuticals and personal care products and recycled water need to be evaluated in the context of other risks. We have found that the intakes of pharmaceuticals and personal care products in recycled water are orders of magnitude less than the allowed intakes of regulated chemicals in drinking water. We have also found that cumulative doses from pharmaceuticals and recycled water are less than single one-time approved therapeutic doses. And finally, that chemical intakes from recycled water generally are insignificant relative to other routes of exposure, such as food and air. And with that, I will wrap up. Thank you.
We wanted to finish off today with the perspective of a medical human health professional. We are very fortunate to have with us today Dr. Stanley Derazinski from the Stanford University School of Medicine. He's a clinical professor of medicine in the Division of Infectious Diseases and Geographic Medicine in Palo Alto. He has served as the hospital epidemiologist for the renowned Sequoia Hospital in Redwood City. He has served as editor and reviewer of medical journals, including Clinical Infectious Diseases and Journal of Infectious Diseases. He has served on two committees of the Infectious Disease Society of America, including the Pharmaceutical Relations Committee and the Antimicrobial Use and Clinical Trials Committee. And you might remember that there was discussion of antimicrobials here a few minutes ago. He has conducted approximately 100 clinical trials, many of which he has designed and initiated, so he is a research expert as well. He is not only a dedicated medical professional in practice and research, but in his public service as well. He has served as medical director of the AIDS services for Santa Clara County. He's founded AIDS Community Research Consortium in Redwood City, and he has helped found healthcare education programs in Africa. So, Dr. Derazinski, thank you for coming today.
Sort of interesting. I was thinking that since some of there were a couple of antibiotics that were listed there in the water, that, you know, most of our antibiotics actually come from soil organisms. So they're actually present in the soil naturally have effects there as well. And I am going to be very, very brief because I was asked to speak on the public health aspects of this issue, and I think I can summarize my take on this very simply. I think you've seen the science, which sort of appears to point us away from recycled or wastewater as an important issue in human health in our society. But also the importance of that, secondary importance of that is to help us understand how important it is to not jump on the first hypothesis that comes out. That is, as the criminal, as the police shouldn't look at the first suspect and to the exclusion of everybody else. Otherwise, they'll be led down the wrong path. The fact that these chemicals are present seems to be less important, as we've seen, than our ingestion of many of these chemicals from other sources. However, none of that, of course, is a reason, as was pointed out by our community speaker, none of that is a reason for complacency. It's important to continue to generate hypotheses about potential risks, because that's the way science is done. There's two ways of getting at that. You can find a chemical and try to find out if it's causing a problem, or you can pick a problem and try to see if there's a relationship to a chemical. In fact, when that has been done, it looks to me from the available information that often the hypothesis loses. For instance, we heard the discussion of reduced sperm counts and the likelihood that that has reasons, if it actually even exists, reasons other than anything related to chemical exposure in water. A recent case control study tested the hypothesis that breast cancer may be related to exposure to these compounds, and that came out to find no such evidence. But nonetheless, and by the way, all of this, I think it's important to recognize, is occurring at a time when human health in the United States continues to improve, as do lifespans. So the paradox that as we get healthier and live longer, we worry much more about our health. Maybe that's not a paradox, but it's certainly a truth. So I think that the importance from the public health point of view is that we continue to have strong public health systems that look for anomalies, look for connections, but to do it in a rational and scientific fashion. And my feeling is that your program has certainly been a seems to me to be an excellent one and one that is being very closely monitored. I congratulate you on trying to look at all aspects in such depth as has been done today. I mean, I certainly learned a lot from these discussions today. Thank you.
But before summarizing the speaker's main points, I wanted to point out what some of the things that the city is doing and intends to do to address this issue of pharmaceuticals and personal care product presence or potential presence in recycled water. The scientific work that you heard about today is being summarized, plus hundreds of times more information is being summarized in a technical document that will be available in a short time in association with the city's discharge compliance project draft environmental impact report. The city is in the process of developing a pharmaceutical take-back program for implementation here in the Santa Rosa area. That program would provide a place for people to bring their excess pharmaceuticals and personal care products for proper disposal as an alternative to flushing them down the toilet. And I think it's worth pointing out, too, that Senator Simidian in Sacramento has proposed SB 966, which would require vendors of pharmaceuticals to have a program to take them back. And we'll be keeping you advised of that legislation in the future. In terms of additional treatment, the city is looking at two main thrusts. One is to evaluate the existing treatment facility to determine how it can be optimized to further remove compounds. You heard today that tertiary treatment removes quite a few down to a relatively low level, but there's been research done to indicate that systems can be optimized, and Dan Carlson, operating the treatment plant, is looking at means of doing more optimization at the treatment plant for this purpose. And as part of the discharge compliance project, you will have the option of identifying reverse osmosis membrane treatment as an additional means of treatment prior to discharge. The city is also participating financially and otherwise in a program and a project being undertaken by the Water Reuse Foundation to evaluate, to develop better risk assessment tools for personal care and pharmaceutical products in recycled water also. So with that, I want to first thank the speakers for taking the time to put together their information for today to share it with you. I know for each of them it was quite a commitment of time, and that they had to move their schedule around to make this possible, and I personally thank them for their commitment to serve the board in this fashion today. Just to quickly summarize, I want to just raise a couple of quick points that I got out of today's presentation. One is that these compounds are ubiquitous. They are everywhere, essentially, and that natural processes can remove them, but they remain present in the environment through and degrade at under a natural process at different rates in different kinds of media, in water, in air, in soil. There are analytical methods that will continue to improve, and we will continue to find more and more of these compounds at lower and lower levels until we're able to, in the case of some compounds, detect single molecules of them. So once they have been manufactured, they don't all disappear ever, and some of them end up in our recycled water, and we need to remember that, and we need to remember that even though we may not be able to measure them, they may have effects. Even though we can measure them, they may not have effects, or their effects may be much smaller than the effects seen from other exposure pathways, such as natural compounds existing in food and so forth. I think Brenda reflected the concern that remains. We have science, we have medicine, but everybody is still concerned about these compounds. The perception is important, and we have an obligation to continue to focus on this issue and bring back to you information as it becomes available. So with that, I will retire and turn it back over to you, Mr. Chairman.
I would like to thank Dr. Dubrow and Ms. Edelman, Dr. Snyder, Ms. Kennedy, and Dr. Tuzinski for taking the time to be with us today. It would be certainly presumptuous on my part to say I now understand the field. I certainly don't, but I certainly appreciate your presentations to us as we struggle to understand all the things that impact our wastewater stream and potable water supply. It's time in the agenda for us to ask questions. I have to admit that I'm overwhelmed by the information I've just been given. The only question that I have that seems to yet be confusing to me, and that is we didn't have much discussion on combinations of products and any cumulative effect that that might have, and I presume there's a lot of research going on that in various fields, and it may not be any of you speakers' areas, but is there research going on that? That's a question that I'd like to have answered. And are there other questions then from other members of the board? Board Member Holt?
Yes, I have two questions. First one's for Dr. Dubrow. You mentioned that many of these compounds were hydrophilic. They were dissolved in the water. And my question is, during the activated sludge treatment process, with the reactions that take place there, are some of these then absorbed or adsorbed onto the materials that settle out and thus taken out of the process?
Simple answer to your question, from my understanding, yes. There is a fractionation from the water to the solid phase. There's a biodegradation element in that, too, where they get broken down either into metabolites or in mineralized to inert compounds. But there is, from my understanding, as these compounds come in from the raw sewage and go through the process, they fraction out either into the liquid or the solid phase of the activated sludge process.
Thank you. My second question is for the panel in general. And do any of you recommend that any food crops that are irrigated with recycled water be monitored for possible carry through of endocrine disruptors or personal care products into that crop?
Excuse me. There has been a lot of interest in whether that happens, but generally plants don't accumulate organic compounds. Now, we've had some discussions, and there's a lot of work to be done, but it would be very costly, and even if it does, I wouldn't expect high levels. Inorganic chemicals like metals and such can accumulate, but organics is very unusual. Well, I can respond a little bit to your synergism question,
yes,
if you will. The World Health Organization tackled that exact topic of synergy, being that two chemicals aren't additive. There's no question about additivity. If you have one in one, you get two. But when you get one in four, that's fairly unusual. And one of the largest papers on synergism was retracted from science, you know, years ago, so that's become kind of a flagship. But the World Health Organization, I think, had pretty sage advice. They said that the safety factors that I showed that are built into coming up with an MCL are probably sufficient to cover any synergy as we know it now. In other words, if you put a 1,000, 3,000-fold safety factor above an ADI, the World Health Organization has said that that is probably sufficient to cover any synergy as we know it. Now, whether or not the state of science will change, I don't know. But that's what the World Health Organization's position has been.
Okay. Thank you. Questions?
No.
This is a more formalized study session than we usually have here at the Board of Public Utilities because we thought there might be a greater community interest, and obviously we've brought a field of experts in to hear their opinions and deeply appreciate their time. And so I have to take the study session and kind of warp it into a more formal situation. So I'm going to limit each of you to about 3 minutes. If there are things that you need answered, there are consultants and staff at the city that can direct any questions that you may have subsequent to this meeting. And obviously, these are issues that this board and city council will be continuing to study, along with some of the other elements that we find in our wastewater stream. This is the beginning of this process, and certainly not the end of the process. With that, the first card I have is Neil Nebler. Is that correct? Nell, I'm sorry. And when you get to the mic, if you'd give us your address and any group that you're representing, please.
Hi, my name is Nell Niebler, and I am representing the Owl Foundation, and I just want to read. It's a letter to the public utility members from H.R. Downs. My address is 735 Grant Avenue in Healdsburg. So, I can read. This is the letter. Dear public utility members, in the last few years, both the public and the scientific community have become increasingly aware of and alarmed at the potential and real risks of allowing partially treated sewage to enter waterways or to be used on crops, golf courses, or schoolyards. Evidence that partially treated sewage causes demonstrable harm has been mounting for years, and confirmation of this harm can be found all over the world. The main thing to grasp about partially treated sewage is that the considerable risks involved with its use are completely unnecessary and avoidable. There is no reason to use contaminated water for any purpose. Many communities around the world, including Orange County, California, Scottsdale, Arizona, and the city-state of Singapore, operate modern treatment plants. Modern treatment plants remove everything from sewage that is not the molecule H2O. The product from modern treatment plants is literally pure water and nothing else. Since modern treatment plants produce pure water, they have many advantages far beyond simple sewage treatment. With pure water, you can not only irrigate crops with no risk whatsoever, you can inject pure water into groundwater aquifers and restore damaged levels. Even better, pure water from modern treatment plants will dilute naturally occurring contaminants in groundwater like arsenic, radium, radon, uranium, etc., making the groundwater quality better than before. Pure water also has a high monetary value and can be sold to customers as pure water. Partially treated sewage is a hard sell, and as we have already seen in Sonoma County, many farmers, grape growers, and other groups quite naturally resist its use, and some have gone to court over the issue. There is a clear and present danger that spreading partially treated sewage on groundwater recharge lands can contaminate underlying groundwater aquifers. Even regular water, water currently sold that is extracted from surface sources like rivers or reservoirs, may be intentionally decontaminated with chemical additives, for example, chlorine. Pure water is pure water and is a higher purity than the clean water we currently use. There are three serious health concerns with partially treated sewage. Drugs, both legal and illegal drugs, remain in partially treated sewage. A family of chemicals called phthalates that have virtually the same biological effect on living organisms as the hormone estrogen, and three so-called emerging contaminants. This last category is by far the most troublesome. As you will see in the Owl Foundation reader that accompanies this address, partially treated sewage contains many diverse chemicals that can and do react in unpredictable ways. For example, acetamiphen and chlorine can combine to produce two completely new toxicants, neither of which was introduced into the waste stream. These two toxic chemicals arose spontaneously by simply allowing partially treated sewage to fester. The most worrisome characteristic of this phenomenon is that the chemical reactions were completely unpredictable. The discovery that partially treated sewage is itself an active laboratory creating completely new chemicals is an important fact to bear in mind. the fact that partially treated sewage is creating new toxicants by merely sitting there proves that no one knows what is in partially treated sewage. Indeed, no one could possibly know what is in it, let alone what will be in it, without accounting for every single chemical constituent and demonstrating every possible permutation.
Are you approaching the conclusion of the letter?
Yes.
Okay.
Claims that partially treated sewage is safe for any use cannot possibly be credible. It is impossible to know as a fact that this material is safe because it is impossible to account for all the possible emerging contaminants. The point is that no entity, not grape growers, not school children, not our underground aquifers, should be required to risk contamination on any level, not when modern treatment plants remove all potential risks. Sincerely, H.R. Downs. And I'm going to submit the reader that he referred to.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ann Seeley speaking for Concerned Citizens for Santa Rosa. First, I very much appreciate this session. I think it's the most forthright, honest addressing of this one portion of what you are responsible for, and making it a public forum is a good thing. The only thing I'm sorry I didn't hear about is the specifics about agricultural reuse of the water, about any studies that are extant, but I suppose there are other avenues to find those. Concerned citizens' greatest interests are the greatest use of all water in the county, and we all understand why. And secondly, protection of ratepayers from expensive regional reuse programs that are not accepted by the receiving areas. I was part of a group that promoted agricultural reuse of wastewater in the late 1990s, early 2000s, and promoted the upsizing of the pipe going north to the geysers so that agricultural reuse in the North County could be done. I've been frustrated at how slowly that project has taken form, but there are many reasons. To finish with, I'd just like to say Concerned Citizens for Santa Rosa will sponsor a community discussion sometime in the near future, in which we hope to have a level playing field, a Q&A session that includes members of city staff and city consultants, people in the community of the sub-regional system, as well as people out in the county and outside of the sub-regional system who are in areas that will be used as receiving areas. I would appreciate if anybody who's interested in being involved in this discussion would send me an email. My email is aeseeley, as in Ann Elizabeth Seeley, at sonic.net. I will give you further information pending that when we figure it out more. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Lois Stoppel. I live at 11730 McPeak Road in Forestville. And I'm representing myself and many of my fellow citizens. I want to point out that no scientific research has ever shown the long-term, that is the 20 to 100-year effects on exposure to these toxins in our water system. And on this truth alone, to allow the potential endangerment of the health of the river, its wildlife, as well as the thousands of people who use the river for swimming and drinking, is unethical. As the power holders here, it is your duty and responsibility to use all possible means to purify the river, rather than even raising the possibility of polluting it any further. Another thing I want to bring up, a very simple long-term green solution to sewage problems would be to legalize the use of compost toilets. These systems have been used in Scandinavia, Europe, and Asia for a very long time now and are available to homeowners as a practical, economic, and modern solution. In these times where so much green development is taking place, to continue to deny the value of compost toilets in water conservation appears backward and absurd. But thank you very much.
My name's Chris DeGabriel. I'm the manager of the North Marin Water District in Novato, and also the chair of the Technical Advisory Committee to the Water Advisory Committee of Sonoma County Water Agency. And I just wanted to thank the Board of Public Utilities and the City of Santa Rosa for bringing in the panel of experts to educate not only the public but the water contractors. I think we're represented by a majority of folks here today. The Water Agency is here, North Marin, Marin Municipal, Rohnert Park, Petaluma, Santa Rosa staff, and Windsor. So we all learned an awful lot. Also encouraged to see California Department of Health Services here. Hopefully this will provide some information for them so that whatever decision the Board of Public Utilities and City of Santa Rosa comes up with for their incremental recycled water project discharge option, we won't be faced with additional treatment of the drinking water. That's our concern going forward. I think you recognize that, and I'm again want to thank you for putting on the workshop and inviting us all. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ann Maurice, Ad Hoc Committee for Clean Water, P.O. Box 484, Occidental 95465. I am very, very pleased to be here. I haven't been participating in very many city council or BPU meetings recently, but I used to in the not-too-distant past. And I am proud to say that the issues that you are discussing now, I'm just really pleased. For people who think that there is no change or you know, there's a lot of people who feel like you can't fight City Hall. There's been a lot of argument regarding environmental issues and wastewater produced by Santa Rosa. And we can be very proud of this meeting that you've had today in addressing these issues. I remember when people poo-pooed all of these concerns about estrogenic chemicals, and you certainly are not doing that by this level of discussion. And I also want to appreciate the programs that I've heard mentioned, like the pharmaceutical take-back. I'm not assuaged by the presentations that I've heard. I'm not calmed by it or feeling as though there's no threat. I think that there is another side of the story, and I think you can find some experts who might alarm you regarding the presence of the pharmaceuticals. I think in general the tone was don't worry about it, that the regulated chemicals pose a greater risk than these pharmaceuticals and personal care products. I think you might find there's another side of the story. So with that being my point of view, I think your pharmaceutical take-back program is fantastic. I very much appreciate that the representative or senator, I guess it's Senator Simidian, wanting to require that. I think that's terrific. That you have a staff member looking into biological treatment of wastewater and seeing if that can help remove pharmaceuticals, that's fantastic also. And that the Santa Rosa's Utilities Department has been in the forefront regarding biological treatment. There was a conference on biological treatment of wastewater, which happened maybe 5 years ago or more, sponsored by the City of Santa Rosa. Not only that, you engage in ultraviolet treatment of wastewater. I don't know how common that is around the country, but people might look into the difference between ultraviolet treatment and chlorination with regards to removing some of these compounds. And also you discharge to the geysers. I supported your discharge to the geysers. Not many people, maybe no organizations in the environmental community did. They talked about recycle and reuse, okay? And recycle and reuse may be appropriate for newspaper and aluminum cans. But when you're talking now about some of these compounds in wastewater, frankly, I supported your discharge to the geysers because I thought that was the safest thing to do, considering the chemicals and compounds. Irrigation of non-food crops, I think, is another wise thing to promote. People promoted irrigation of redwoods years ago precisely because of that, because maybe redwoods can help us in this regard since we don't eat them, we don't consume them. I think Mr. Holt's question with... Oops.
Go ahead.
Mr. Holt's question with regards to monitoring food crops, I think, is an excellent one, because there really wasn't much of that in the presentations. It's not just accumulation in the tissue, but the presence in the fluids in the water. that my understanding is that the reason that pharmaceuticals work in our bodies is because they don't degrade readily. They're highly stable compounds. Our digestive system doesn't take them apart. That's how they're able to get into our bloodstream. So that being the case, they don't degrade easily by the wastewater treatment plants either, and they don't degrade readily in the ground. So, see, I'm still in favor of your geysers project, that the same logic that people use for not wanting the wastewater in the river should operate the same way. If they don't want it in dilution in the river, why would you want it full strength on food crops? And just our intuition tells us that our bodies are created to keep our intake valve as far away as possible on our chassis from the outflow. And I think if we keep that in mind, you know, maybe we want to regulate ourselves in this arena the same way. And the last thing that I wanted to say is that maybe now is the time to reconsider another project that came before the Board of Public Utilities years ago. And that was questioning whether we should continue to use water as a conduit for waste. That's really what's at the heart of all of these problems. And since we were all imprinted on the flush toilet from the time we were a year and a half, it's a very difficult thing to overcome. But the previous speaker who mentioned composting toilets, Real Goods is a Fortune 500 company, and they sell them. So it's not as though this is fringe technology for some far-out environmentalist hippies. This is very much a technology that you'd look into, and I think some of your staff recommended that you do a pilot project years ago. Maybe it's a time to revisit it. There's also incinerating toilets along with your program, and I would love to help give publicity to add those things to your pharmaceutical take-back and biological treatment investigations. And thank you very much for hosting this meeting.
Thank you, Ms. Maries.
I'm Donna Gallagher, 5025 Country Club Drive, Roner Park. And I didn't go into overwhelm from that presentation because I just got my degree is brand new in January from I studied nutrition and environmental sustainability. I listened and didn't think I would be talking at all now, except for what was missing for me is what I know happens when this kind of chemicals are in the water. I teach physicians about nutrition and the nutrients depleted by prescription drugs. The most toxic prescription drugs that deplete nutrients are the Lipitors and the Zocors and antibiotics, which are on the top of your list that you have. What they deplete are your B vitamins, zinc, and CoQ10. The net result of CoQ10 being depleted in a human body is high blood pressure, congestive heart failure, kidney failure, and the list is longer than that. We don't even have time. B vitamins cause mental depression, psychosis, different mental disorders, and you don't replace your blood cells correctly, etc. And these are the things that are being depleted by the drugs in the water. Lastly, zinc. That is the thing that's affecting especially the sperm count and the changes. Zinc affects your immune system. It's the most important mineral because it affects our whole immune system and many of our metabolic, or like for diabetes and that type of thing. So the nutritional aspect is something I was kind of listening to see if that was going to be brought up. We're going to need to make investments in cleaning this water up completely, or we will pay a higher price in the nutritional disorders that will come from this. We already have depleted soils of minerals. We already know there's a lot of things missing in our food. This will further cause damage to human beings. So we've seen a lot in the past month about running out of water and drought and things like that. I think all of us need to respect that this is a finite source. We need to invest in it and save it. And the truth is, I'm not even an anti-development person, but I would have to say that everyone in this room with common sense should ask their cities to not issue another permit to build anything else that uses more water until we figure out this problem. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Gallagher. There were comments, suggestions, and thoughts from the speakers. Dr. Smith, I think it's probably most appropriate. I know you're prepared to have me ask you to make response to comments. Personally, I feel like I've had so much information thrown at me today that it's difficult to respond. And so I would allow you to get off the hook if you agree with me. I think it's been a wonderful opportunity for us to move into better understanding how pharmaceuticals fit into our wastewater stream and some of the things that we may wish to pursue further to keep them out of that waste stream. And this, my notes told me that I was to make closing comments. I think what's appropriate is that I'm making opening comments. And I think that, unless some of the board members have further comments to make, would conclude this study session. And I deeply appreciate the experts who came and spoke to us. I know it took a great deal of time out of your schedules, and your information was very timely and very welcome. I also appreciate the public being here, and I know you'll be with us as we move forward. Thank you very much.